Okay, so let's continue. So just to remind you, in the last lecture, we discussed the notion of covariant differentiation. We developed nice formulas for the covariant derivative, including a nice formula for this object, the Christoffel symbol, gamma alpha beta theta, in terms of the metric, and I'll remind you of that formula since it's important. This is G alpha phi of R by 2, then G alpha phi, G theta phi, G alpha phi beta plus G beta phi alpha minus G alpha beta phi. So this is a good formula to remember. Apart from raising an index, so the easier formula to remember is the one with all three indices lowered. Gamma has two indices that are symmetric and one special one. The special one is going to be raised. But the guy with three indices lowered has the two indices special. You know, you get G of one of those and the special one, comma the other one. Other one in the pair, plus G of the other one in the pair, times the special one, comma, the first one in the pair, minus G of the pair, comma, the special one. And then there's a half. Okay? This formula you'll use, if you use general relativity, you use many times. It's a good thing to remember. Okay. This formula was obtained assuming compatibility of the metric with our notion of covariant differentiation, and assuming that gamma was a symmetric object, had no anti-symmetric piece, which were minimalistic assumptions, and which are assumptions that will, you know, this is the formula that will appear in equations of physics. Okay, then at the end of the next class, we started a discussion of the motion of a particle. Through an arbitrary metric. We consider the Lagrangian S is equal to M square root of G alpha beta x alpha dx alpha by d lambda dx beta by d lambda d lambda, and we had a minus sign. And at the end of the last class, we'd worked out the equation of motion dual to this that followed from this Lagrangian. And that equation of motion took the following form. It took the form that is sometimes written as d by d tau of dx alpha by d tau is equal to 0. So covariant version of acceleration is equal to 0. And what did we mean by this object? What we meant by this object more precisely was dx alpha by d tau of d alpha, okay, acting on dx alpha by d tau equals 0. And what was tau? Tau was equal to the proper time along the, so d tau more precisely was along the well line, exactly. So d tau was equal to g alpha beta dx alpha dx beta along the well. Minus. Metric, I should remember, is minus plus 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 plus. Yeah, so over the minus. Yes. No. We're using Landau's funny conventions. Right. So our metric is plus minus minus minus, and therefore there's no minus. Okay. Excellent. Fine. Now, in the first, I would like in today's class to wrap up our discussion, to wrap up our basic discussion of the motion of physics in curved spaces. You'll get an assignment sometime next week in which you'll do many exercises to get familiar with this stuff. But there are several things we need to discuss in class. The first thing I want to discuss is the is the motion of a free particle in curved space in a little more detail. I want to first tell you about the Hamiltonian formulation of this problem, which is extremely unnatural and very ugly, because Hamiltonians make a special choice of time and break the beautiful covariance of this problem. But then we'll go from there to the Hamilton-Jacobi formulation of motion of a particle in general relativity, which regains the covariance. That is very beautiful. We'll talk about motion of light, geometric optics in general relativity, and briefly discuss electromagnetism in curved space. So let's see how much of that we can do today. Okay. So the first thing I want to do is to work out the canonical formulation of this action. Okay? Now, we wrote this action in this nice covariant form, and there's actually a way of working out the canonical formulation also in this covariant form, where you take lambda to be your time parameter. That's a nice discussion, but not needed for what we're going to do here, and we're not going to do it. What we're going to do is to break the covariance of the theory by choosing time as special. Okay? So we'll choose lambda, this parameter lambda, to be time. Okay? So S is equal to minus m g alpha beta square root of dx alpha by dt dx beta by dt times dt. Now this alpha beta index runs over time and space. So dx alpha by dt when alpha is equal to 0 is just 1. It's dt by dt. But when alpha, so the alpha indices is equal to 0, stands for time, and I, which stands for space. Okay? And this formula is accurate, though you have to remember that x0 is equal to t, so dx0 by dt is equal to 1. Okay? This is, of course, this funny thing is the breaking of the covariance. It's not very pleasant, but bear with me for 5 minutes, because it's just going to be intermediate breaking of covariance. Okay. So now let's work out the canonical momenta. So now that we fixed time, what are the coordinates of our problem? It's clear the coordinates are xi. I is equal to 1 to 3, if you're living in four-dimensional space-time. As we will be for a while. Okay. Okay, so we've got three coordinates. So we want to find the three momenta corresponding to these three coordinates. So what are the three canonical momenta? So the three canonical momenta are, what's the rule? We differentiate this with respect to x, I dot. Okay, so what do we get? We get minus m times square root of this business. Times the derivative of this object, and we should put a 2 because there's a half in differentiating square root, but then times the derivative of this object with respect to xi dot. So if I take the derivative of this object with respect to xi dot, I kill this guy, for instance. There's a factor of 2 because the two guys I could have killed. That index becomes an I. The other index runs over all variables. Okay? So I'm just writing down the answer. It's g I alpha dx alpha by dt. Okay? So pi is equal to. I forgot the factor of 2 because there were the two choices here, so that 2 cancels this 2. Okay? In the special case that the metric was suppose, we look at the special case where gi0 suppose. Gi0 was equal to 0. So the metric had mixed space elements, but time was by itself. Suppose that was the case. This guy would have, would be some linear combinations of the velocities. Okay. In the case that gi0 was not 0, it would be a linear combination of the velocities plus some function of x's. That function of x is being gi0. Okay. So these are the canonical momenta of the problem. Now, the next thing I'm going to do is to work out the Hamiltonian. Okay? So, so the next thing I'm going to do is to work out the Hamiltonian of the problem. Okay. So the Hamiltonian is what? It's equal to dxi by d tau, by dt, times pi minus the Lagrangian. Okay? So let's work that out. Okay, let's work it out up here. So, so let's work out the Hamiltonian. So the Hamiltonian is this object. So let's work it out. So we get dxi by dt, and then substitute for what pi was. So minus m into gi alpha dx alpha by dt times the square root. Minus the Lagrangian. Now the Lagrangian was minus square root. So that becomes plus square root. Okay? So we'll write this as, and the Lagrangian also had the m, so we'll take the m out common. So we've got m divided by square root into g alpha beta dx alpha by dt dx beta by dt minus dxi by dt gi alpha dx alpha by dt. Now you might think that this was zero. Yes, but it's not zero because the I index runs only over space. So all that remains is the time part. Okay, so we get the formula h is equal to m by square root times this index alpha we keep was common, but the beta index being 0 is all that counts. Beta index being 0 gives dx 0 by dt, which is 1, times g alpha 0. Okay, so we get g alpha 0 times dx alpha by dt. Now, let's say this in a slightly nice way. Look at this object. The object here, P alpha. Let's define this object P alpha, which is equal to dx x alpha by square root g alpha beta g theta phi dx theta dx phi . Okay, or if you want you could divide by dt dt here and divide by dt there. This is an obviously covariant object because it's built this object transforms like a vector, and this object is an invariant. Okay, so it's obviously a covariant vector. A vector with one index up. Maybe it's called contravariant vector. Okay? And now let's look at the formula. Oh, you'll remember this one, right? This was, I'll just write this down. Gi alpha dx alpha by dt by square root. Look at the formula for the spatial momentum and for the Hamiltonian. The momentum conjugate and for the Hamiltonian. Okay, you see that the spatial momentum is the ith component of the object built by multiplying minus m times this object lowered. Okay, so now, so what I'm going to do is, of course, I define p alpha just by lowering the index here with the metric as usual. Okay, and so to be specific, it's g alpha beta dx beta by square root. That's p alpha. And then if we look at this formula and this formula, we identify the following. We identify that pi is simply equal to pi, by which this sounds like a tautology, but what I mean is that the momentum conjugate to the ith coordinate, with a minus m. Okay, let me define these p's with an m. But let's not. Do we want to define them with a minus? That is our next question. Now we're in this brilliant convention such that this has a minus in it, right? So, yeah, I think it's the natural definition is with a minus. So that if there's a positive velocity, it's a positive. It's a question of whether you want upper or low. I don't know. Okay. Let's just stick to this definition and fine. So then pi, where this p is, okay, momentum conjugate to xi is equal to, okay, so just to be, now I'm going to achronologically change the notation to make things to make things clearer. I'm going to call the momentum conjugate pi I, okay? Again, these vectors are called pi's, p alphas. So we conclude that pi I is equal to minus m times, we put the m in this here, so minus pi and h is equal to p0. Okay? But we know, of course, sort of more or less by construction, that pi alpha transformed like a covariant four vector. Pi alpha, however, is, as we've seen, h times minus pi. Okay? So we conclude that the four column object that you build, by whose first element is h, and the remaining three elements are the momentum conjugate to the ith coordinates, transform like a four-dimensional vector, a covariant vector, you know, one form. Pi. Thank you. Yes. Right. And pi transform like a four vector, but h and minus pi I transform like a four vector. Thank you. Okay, excellent. Okay? So, you know, this is sort of nice. We take this completely non-covariant formulation, and we start seeing some sort of hidden covariance. The hidden covariance is that if you take the Hamiltonian, which in the end is the generator for motions in time, and add it to the momenta, which in the end are the generators for motion in space, you put them together, you get a nice covariant four vector. Not too crazy, but nice. Okay. Now, the real reason I'm telling you all of this is the following. You might remember from our discussion of classical mechanics last year that one way to view classical mechanics is through the so-called Hamilton-Jacobi formulation. Okay? And since it's been over a semester since all of you mastered the Hamilton-Jacobi formulation, I'll give you a 2-minute review of that. You remember what I'm leading to is to write down the Hamilton-Jacobi equations for the motion of a particle in arbitrary curved space. They're very beautiful equations, and they're often the most useful way to solve practical problems in general relativity. The more elementary textbooks don't emphasize this, but you know, real master like Landau, you know, gets to the heart of the matter. Okay, so yes.
Can we build the phase space using four vector and the space-time component?
Okay, if you try to build a phase space where there are four coordinates and four canonical momenta, you're going to land up in a constrained formulation of phase space.
You have the energy and p-squared relation.
That's right. So you can do this, and it's the analog of what we do in string theory. I mean, it's if you want a manifestly covariant quantization of this particle, that's what you would do. Okay? This is very useful for formal purposes. It's useful when you're trying to make a description of quantum mechanics based on this classical formulation. But we're not going to get into that now, because for actually solving problems, classical motion, it's not particularly useful. Okay? It's a good question, and you can do it, and it has many interesting applications, but we're not going to get into that. Though I'd be very happy to discuss it with anyone who wants to. Probably out of class. No. Okay. So, let's remember how the Hamilton-Jacobi formulation of classical mechanics worked. Suppose you've got some initial conditions at some initial time. Let's say xi and ti. And you have the final conditions, let's say xf, like x initial and x final and tf. That is the very starting point of the discussion of classical mechanics, that fixing these initial and final conditions, you can find an action that goes between them, and you know the action is extremized over parts, blah, 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 blah. That's what you do in the first lecture in classical mechanics. But about the 20th lecture in classical mechanics, you return to this thing and say, let's not worry about the action as a formal object anymore, but let's see what we can find about the value of the action as a function of initial position, final position, initial time, and final time. Okay? And something that we derived, and I will not try to go through again unless you're very uncomfortable, and I might have to look up the text to get the minus signs correct, but I'll do that. I'll guess signs and I'll check them. Was that the derivative of this action with respect to Tf was the Hamiltonian, whereas the derivative of the action with respect to xfi was equal to pi. With a minus. One of them has a minus sign. Now which one? I'll check. Okay, I've got to try. Oh, two, which is two. Okay. Yes, I'm assuming two in Landau. Two is the final time, so I've got it opposite. Okay. Then. This is something you can quite easily check. Okay. That you think of the action now as a function of this initial time, initial position, initial time, final position, final time. Very similar relations hold for differentiation with respect to initial position, initial time, but with an extra minus sign. Okay, but we will not care about that. We're going to think of it for fixed initial position and time as a function of final position and final time. And then what you can do is to turn this equation here into a differential equation, a partial differential equation for the action. And the way we do it is as follows. We have the del S by del T. Now all times and all positions are going to be final, so I'll drop the F subscript. Del S by del T was equal to minus of H, but H is a function of positions and coordinates. Positions and momenta. And then we use this formula to substitute in what pi I was in terms of the action. Okay, so we get an equation that says that del S by del T is equal to minus H of xi del S by del xi. Okay? And then if you know the form of the Hamiltonian for your problem, as we do in our problem. Okay? If you know the form of the Hamiltonian in your problem, then all you have to do, then you just plug in and you get a partial differential equation for this function S. Now, as we discussed in our classical mechanics class a semester ago, this sounds like antithesis of progress, right? You take a problem which involves solving ordinary differential equations and convert it into a problem solving partial differential equations. Sounds like a weird thing to do. However, there are many formal and sometimes practical uses of this. And how do you use this practically? Well, you use this practically in the following way. I'll remind you because we're going to be doing this repeatedly. What you try to do is to find, let's now specialize to the case there are three position coordinates. What you are supposed to do is to find a three-parameter solution to this set of partial differential equations. You remember? The general solution of the partial differential equations depends on an infinite number of parameters, initial values of functions. But we aren't interested in the general solution. We just want a three-parameter set of solutions. If you have more, fine. Set all the other coefficients to zero. Choose three parameters. Okay. And what we were supposed to do was to find some action that satisfied this equation. It was a function of x size and of t and of these three parameters which we called alpha. Okay, let's label this up. Let's call this F. And then we did something very clever. We used this S, the thing that we found, as the generating function of a canonical transformation regarding xi's as what they were, the old positions, and alpha's as the new momentum. I'll remind you that canonical transformations are generated by a generating function, which are a function of one's choice of new things, one choice of old things. You could have new positions, old positions, new positions, old momenta, new momenta, old positions, you know, any of the four combinations is allowed. We made this one choice. Okay? Now, the next thing we did was to say, well, after finding this, we found the new Hamiltonian. Now this H prime was equal to old Hamiltonian plus, and I hope I'm getting the signs right, del F by del T. Okay? But del F by del T was the old Hamiltonian with the minus sign. So that was equal to zero. So the point of doing this canonical transformation was we move to a new set of variables in terms of which the Hamiltonian vanishes. Therefore, all new variables, positions as well as momenta, were constants. Okay? And then we actually found solutions to the equations of motion by doing the following maneuver. We said, well, what are the new momenta? According to the rules of canonical transformations, the new momenta are the generating, are the derivative of the generating function. Sorry, the new positions. What are the new positions? They're the derivatives of the generating function with respect to the new momenta. Okay? So these new positions, whatever they are, we call them beta, only thing about them that we care is that they're constants. Because the Hamiltonian expressed in terms of new variables was zero. That was equal to del F by del alpha I. This now gave you three equations which you can use to solve for xi of t in terms of six unknown parameters. The six unknown parameters being the three alphas and the three betas. And that gives you the most general solution to the equations of motion. Because the most general solution of the equations of motion is in terms of six unknown parameters. Okay? Was this lightning review clear? Any questions or comments about it? If you've completely forgotten about this stuff, you're going to have to go back to our good old textbook from last semester and read about it again. Okay? This is assuming you more or less remember to jog your memory. Okay? Great. So, this is how the Hamilton-Jacobi formulation works. Now, what we're going to do is to work out the Hamilton-Jacobi equations in general relativity. Okay. So, what we want, what's the idea? The idea is to find this equation, right? This equation that, some equation, the partial differential equation that relates del S by del T, and of course the way of constructively doing it is as I described. But in our case, there's a bit of a shortcut. Shortcut means saves you two lines of algebra. It's not much of a shortcut. And that's this. What we remember is that P alpha is equal to H and minus pi I. Okay? But P alpha satisfies a very simple identity. The identity is that G alpha beta, P alpha P beta is equal to, well, what is it equal to? Well, it's equal to G alpha beta, and let's remember the definitions now, D X alpha. X alpha means DX alpha lowered with the metric. DX beta. Now, this is the same as, okay, let me write it once again. Square root of G alpha theta phi dx theta dx phi, the whole thing squared, because each of these terms had a 1 over square root. Then there was an m, so this becomes an m square. Okay? Now, a great thing about indices is that indices, once contracted, you can raise one, lower the other. And this cancels this. Okay? So we get the equation that G alpha beta, P alpha P beta is equal to M squared. Let's find a formula for P alpha in terms of the action. That's simple. What do we know? We know that P alpha is equal to H minus pi I. And we know that H is equal to del S by del T, but with a minus. Pi I is equal to del S by del X I with a plus. Substitute these two into that. That gives you that P alpha is equal to minus del S by del T del S by del X I. It's important that we got the overall minus, because now this is a manifestly covariant expression. Okay, this is equal to minus del S by del X alpha. Okay? And then the fact that this is true gives us the Hamilton-Jacobi equation. G alpha beta del s by del x alpha del s by del x beta is equal to m squared. Okay. So this is the beautiful Hamilton-Jacobi equation that governs the motion of a particle in an arbitrary curved space. How do you use it? Remember, the idea is to somehow find a three-parameter set of solutions to these equations, and then differentiate those solutions with respect to the three parameters, set those derivatives to constant. That gives you the solutions to the equations of motion. Okay? Great. Before we actually start using it, actually there'll be some time before we start using this, because we have to actually find what metrics for realistic situations are. We don't yet know the rules for that. You know, we haven't yet discussed the equivalence of Newton's laws. Okay, we have to do that, but before we actually start using it for practical purposes, there are a couple of formal things about this that I wanted to say. The first formal thing is the following. So far, we have discussed the motion of a massive particle in an arbitrary curved space. We will also be interested in discussing the motion of massless particles in an arbitrary curved space, the motion of light through a curved geometry. But the action we've written down so far has not been good enough to deal with that. Because if you take the action we've written down, you set m to 0, you get 0. Okay? Now, so in order to understand how to describe the motion of light through an arbitrary curved space, let's go back to first principles. So what is light? Light, in the end, classically, is a solution to a wave equation. So the thing that we want to do is to understand how to describe solutions to wave equations, massless wave equation. How to describe solutions to wave equations in arbitrary curved space. Now, actually light comes from solving the equations of Maxwell electrodynamics, as you very well know. And these equations are wave equations with irritating complications associated with polarization. Okay? I'm going to illustrate everything important in the simpler case of looking at a minimally coupled scalar wave equation. Okay? So, consider, so the light will obey a relativistic wave equation, which is slightly complicated because of the indices in the Maxwell fields. But let's, as a toy model of this problem, let's study the wave equation that comes from the Lagrangian. This is the, people sometimes put a 2 here, that won't bother us, a half. This is the Lagrangian of so-called minimally coupled scalar field. Does this make you uncomfortable, by the way, to see Lagrangians for, does a formula like this make you uncomfortable? Does it make anyone uncomfortable? Is this familiar? Have you seen formulas like Lagrangians integrated over all of space before? No. Have you seen a Lagrangian for Maxwell electrodynamics? So it's very similar. So what's the Lagrangian for Maxwell electrodynamics? It's integral, well, in curved space, it's integral square root g, f alpha beta, well, by 4 would be the natural normalization, but okay, doesn't matter the normalizations. So it's some Lagrangian involving fields over all of space. And you get the equations of motion for your theory by varying the action with respect to the fields in the Lagrangian. Are you sure this is familiar? This is familiar? So then this is an easier version of that. Here the fields were a mu of x. Here the fields are phi of x. A mu of x is more complicated than phi of x because there are four a mus to keep track of indices. Phi's are a little simpler. That's why I'm dealing with the phi's rather than the a mus. Okay? Oh, the Lagrangian has no integration sign. Let's call this the action. Well, the Lagrangian actually have an integration sign over space, but not time. So it's in the action, let's say. Right. Okay? Part of the point of this course will be to get familiar with these kind of Lagrangians. The Lagrangian for gravity will be of this general structure. Okay. So, now let's take this Lagrangian and vary it with respect to our scalar field to find the equation of motion for the scalar field. Okay, so what's the general principle? The general principle is that delta S must vanish on shell. So this by 2 goes del mu of delta phi, del mu of phi g mu nu. Now, as always, you're allowed to set the coefficient of delta phi to 0 once you've taken all derivatives and put on the other fields. Okay, so that implies if this is equal to integral of del mu of square root minus g mu nu del nu of phi, delta phi. The only way this can vanish is if we have the equation of motion, del mu of square root minus g mu nu del nu of phi is equal to 0. Now if this is true, it's also true that 1 over square root of g minus g times this is equal to 0, because I can multiply 0 by 1 over square root of minus g. Now, can those of you who've been alert in the last class or who have notes of the last class, tell me if you find this formula familiar. Covariant derivative of what? This is the same as the formula for d mu of phi. You see, you take a covariant derivative and act on a scalar, it's just the ordinary derivative. So this first d mu is just ordinary derivative raised. But when you act with a second covariant derivative, you're acting with a covariant derivative on a vector. That's not the ordinary derivative. But now we're not acting in the most general covariant derivative on vector, we're acting with a covariant derivative contracted with a vector. And you remember we had a simple formula for that. That simple formula evaluated to this. Okay? So this object here, this differential operator is called the Laplacian, the covariant Laplacian. Or, I don't know, box, the Alembertian, I don't know, there are many such names for this thing. It's the natural covariant generalization of del square in flat space. Okay? And see how beautifully it came out of varying the action. This illustrates another general thing. Why did we get a covariant action, a covariant equation of motion? It's because we started with a covariant action. In the action, you might wonder, where was the covariant? Okay, firstly, just to make sure everyone's understanding everything, why did I put the square root g in this action? Exactly. In an earlier class, we had shown that d4x is not generally coordinate invariant. But square root g d4x is. Okay? So this thing is in... This expression is generally coordinate invariant because the d4x goes with square root g. Then I had derivatives here. Why didn't I put covariant derivatives there? I don't know. Because they're scalars. I meant covariant derivatives, but in the special case of scalars, covariant derivatives are the same as ordinary derivatives. Okay? And why did I contract with the upper metric? To make it covariant. That's the only way to get a scalar coordinate invariant out of two lower index vectors. So, at the level of the action, it was really easy to write down a generally coordinate invariant action. And then two lines of algebra gives you an equation that doesn't look generally coordinate invariant. There are no gammas in this equation. All these funny square root g's. But it is. It had to be. As we checked effectively last time. That it's written in terms of covariant derivatives. Okay. Now, there were a lot of questions in earlier classes about, for instance, this metric compatibility condition of the covariant derivative in the metric, you know, where does it come from? You see, once we actually start doing physics, these questions evaporate. Okay? They evaporate because physics is determined by Lagrangian. You start with a Lagrangian like this, you get an equation of motion. This equation of motion can be written in terms of the covariant derivative with the metric compatible connection. So we did some abstract theory at the beginning, that's some blah blah blah. Okay? It's blah 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 that allows you to give good words to the equations you get from physics. But there's no ambiguity in physics, you know. It comes from a nice Lagrangian. Okay? So we should be careful about being too much like mathematicians. You know. Okay. Okay, great. So, fine. So this was a nice equation of motion. Now, you might wonder, what's this guy doing? He was talking about the motion of particles and suddenly he started talking about minimally coupled scalar fields. What's the point? We can't get into the point. Okay. I want to talk about the motion of massless particles. The point was that massless particles really are described by a minimally coupled scalar equation, or some version thereof, a massless scalar equation. So what we want to do is to see how solutions to this equation propagate in a limit where we can think of these solutions as particle length. This is like the classical limit of quantum mechanics, where wave motion becomes particle-like motion. Okay? It's how the emergence of geometric optics, the motion of linear motion of light from Maxwell electrodynamics is in every way analogous, in fact is more or less the same thing as the classical limit of quantum mechanics. Okay, so since you guys have taken several high powered quantum mechanics courses, you know all about this, but I'll just remind you anyway. Okay, I'll just remind you how this works. Okay, just for notation, sometimes I will use the symbols del mu instead of d mu for the covariant derivative. Some textbooks use this symbol, and it's good to get used to both. Okay? So, what? Del mu for d mu. No, the thing you're thinking about is del square. I'm saying d mu is del mu, and d mu is sometimes called del square. Right, I'll also sometimes see. Okay, good. So let's use that notation just to get it familiar. So the equation of motion is del square phi is equal to 0. Now, I am going to solve this equation of motion in a special circumstance. Okay? The circumstance is the under the Eichonall, or in quantum mechanics it's called WKB approximation. Okay? And The way you're going to solve it is the following. You see, this is the basic idea. The basic idea is that you know some exact solutions to these equations. Let's say we were in flat space for a moment. You know some exact solutions to these equations, just plane waves. Plane waves with any momentum. Okay. Now, whenever you know exact solutions to some equations of motion, you've got a family of exact solutions. Like this. You can try to find approximate solutions that piecewise approximate these exact solutions, but where the parameters of this approximation vary slowly in space. So the idea is to try to find solutions which locally look like e to the pi p dot x, but where p itself is a function of x, such that the variation of the function p is on length scales much larger than the wavelength set by p. So that over a region consisting of 1,000 wavelengths, it looks like you've got just a plane wave kind of solution. But as you go slowly varying, you see that p changes. Okay? Now, let's try to make that more precise. What we're trying to say is we're looking for solutions which look like this. So phi is equal to e to the power I times psi, such that the derivatives of psi are not small, because psi you should secretly think of as and so that del psi by del x mu at any value of x, we will in fact call p mu. Maybe it's better to call k mu of x, wave number of x, just as a definition. But you see what I'm getting at, right? This k mu can be anything. As long as it's near some plane wave, not necessarily a long wavelength plane wave. But we don't want k mu's to vary fast. So, second derivatives of psi are small. Okay? So we're in a regime where the regime in which we're functioning is one in which, and now we can make this precise if you like, you see the length scale associated, what we want basically is that a wavelength, the change of a wavelength, over the distance associated with the fractional change of a wavelength, over the distance associated with the wavelength, is small. Okay? Let me make that condition precise just for doing it once. So, this gives you k. So the associated wavelength, so lambda, is of order 1 by k. So 1 by del psi by del x. I'm just doing order of magnitude here, so I'm omitting all indices. Okay? So what's the condition we want? The condition we want is that the fractional change in k over a wavelength is small. So that lambda times del by del x of log of k is much, much less than 1. But lambda is 1 by del psi by del x, and del by del x of log of k is del by del x of k divided by k. So that's like del 2 psi by del x squared over del psi by del x, the whole thing squared, is much, much less. Okay, I'm being rough here, I'm omitting indices. So second derivatives of psi divided by first derivative squared, note this is a dimensionless object, is small. This is the condition under which the WKB or Eichenall approximation works. Okay? Under this condition, what we're basically saying is forget about all second derivatives. Okay. So let's do that. Let's look at phi is equal to e to the I psi. And look at the second. Look at del square of this. Now, what is del square of this? Del square on phi is del mu of phi, which is equal to del mu del times del mu I times del mu psi times e to the phi psi, which is equal to minus of, now that, what? One of these is upper. Yes. Now, There are two terms. I've differentiated so far only once. Good. What remains? So one term is minus del squared psi e to the pi psi. And the remaining term is, this is plus I. And then minus del psi the whole thing squared e to the pi psi. Okay? This is exact manipulation. Okay? But effectively what we're doing in the regime of interest to us is neglecting this term with respect to this term. So, the final equation becomes del psi the whole thing squared is equal to zero. Okay, I've done one rough and dirty thing. I've ignored variations of amplitude in this thing, or equivalently, I've treated psi as a complex number. What I've done is okay in the end, though you may have to. I won't go into the justifications too much. Okay. So we get the equation of geometrical optics, or geometrical wave motion. That is in the Eichenholz approximation, in the WKP approximation. This wave motion is described by the equation del psi the whole thing squared is equal to zero. Now, I'm getting to the point of this thing. Let's look at what equation, you see, you might think that wave motions are very different from classical mechanics. But that's not true. Classical mechanics can be formulated in terms of wave motion, the Hamilton-Jacobi equation. Okay? And let's recall the earlier wave motion associated with the particle moving at mass n that we just derived in the earlier part of this class. It was del s, the whole thing squared, is equal to m squared. These equations are remarkably like each other under the substitution m squared equals zero. Equations being equal could be a coincidence. But the important question is not whether the equations are equal. It's whether the solution to the problem, physical problem of interest is the same. Okay? So, what I'm now going to try to convince you of is that massless motion is like a limit of massive motion. Just in a way that I will try to explain to you. So let's keep this at this similarity at the back of our mind, and let's proceed to study just this wave motion. So we've got this phase of the Eichenholz of the wave equation that is varying according to the equation del psi squared is equal to zero. Now we want to know the answer to the following question. Suppose I produce, okay, now just as in the study of classical mechanics, I'm going to ask you to do the following. I'm going to ask you to take this equation and solve it. That is, I mean, find psi, which is xi, t, and alpha I. For some three parameters, alpha I, however you manage to do it. You know, for instance, these three parameters could label the three momenta at some initial time. This is roughly plane wave at some moment. Okay? It's like, in quantum mechanics, this would be like a basis set of wave functions. Like the plane waves. That's space. Okay? Imagine, it doesn't matter whether you can actually do the solving or not. I'm going to ask you to imagine that you've managed to do the solving. Okay? And then, what we're going to do is to try. Now, this solution that we've got represents, as we've said, something that's a plane wave. That over long distances varies from plane wave. This describes wave motion. What we're interested in, geometrical optics. We're interested in the motion of little wave packets that move more or less like particles. And we want to follow how these particles move. How in quantum mechanics do you make particle-like motion from wave motion? Wave packets. Excellent. So you consider a basis of wave motion, which is plane waves. And then you superpose these to get wave packets. So what you do is exactly what we're going to do here. You take, let's imagine that you've got some g of alpha, which I'll break up into a modulus times e to the power I phi of alpha. So the alpha labels which wave? A wave packet is summing over many different waves with different amplitudes. Okay, so that's what we're doing, times e to the power I psi of xi t and alpha. Okay, such an object now represents a potentially localized thing. How do you estimate where the center of this wave packet is? And how do you estimate the width of this wave packet? Somebody.
Stationary
phase approximation. Exactly. Using the stationary phase approximation, you know, the point is that the variations in the psi are much faster than the variations due to changes of k. Okay? So that justifies the stationary phase approximation, much like it does in quantum mechanics, in the WKB approximation. And in the stationary phase approximation, this wave packet is dominated. Okay? This wave packet receives dominant contributions from those xi and t, such that when xi and t are tuned to those values, the value of the derivative of this, of the integrand with respect to alpha, vanishes. So the center of the wave packet is given by the equation del phi alpha by, of alpha by del of alpha I is equal to, with a minus, is equal to del psi by del alpha I of xi t and alpha. Now, we are going to work with a wave packet that is localized in alpha space around some alpha equals alpha naught. Just like in quantum mechanics, you look at a wave packet as localized both in momentum space and in position space. Okay, that is localized in alpha space about alphas about alpha naught with some thickness. Alpha naught, this thickness is supposed to be small. So here we can, roughly speaking, substitute the value of this derivative at alpha equals alpha naught. So let me define beta I is equal to minus del phi by del alpha I at alpha equals alpha naught. As beta I. Then this equation becomes, let's call it minus, this equation becomes beta I is equal to del psi by del alpha I of xi, t and alpha I. And this is the equation that determines the motion of the center of the wave packet. How do you determine the motion of the center of the wave packet? Alpha is some fixed number. Here you put an alpha naught. It's localized around there. Beta is some fixed number. So you've got three fixed numbers alpha, three fixed number beta. In terms of these three fixed numbers, you solve for xi as a function of t. That determines the motion of the wave packet. Does this sound familiar? It's exactly what we do in the Hamilton-Jacobi equation. Okay? You take this equation, solve it. Remember what we do for the Hamilton-Jacobi equation? You take the equation, solve it in terms of these three alphas. And to find motion, what you do is to differentiate the action with respect to alphas and set that even to a constant. That gives you the motion of the particle. Okay? So you see here in its clearest form the parallel between wave motion and particle motion. Wave motion in the Eichenholz approximation is particle motion. Okay? And the wave, the Eichenholz wave equation, once you identify the Eichenholz wave equation, in this case del psi squared is equal to 0, with the Hamilton-Jacobi equation of the particle. Okay? So, at least, so what have we concluded? We've concluded that two things. We've concluded two things. The first one is that if we are interested in studying the motion of massive particles, we obtain the equation of motion. That is this geodesic equation that we described. Then, in order to study the equation of massive particles, we also looked at this problem in another way, by studying the Hamilton-Jacobi equation for massive particles. Then we studied the motion of massless particles. We didn't have in any clean way the analog of a geodesic equation. But we went back to first principles, asked what massless particles were. And they came out of studying massless waves. And we realized that in the appropriate approximation, the WKB Eichenholz approximation, we got exactly the same mathematical problem as you got for studying massive particles. Upon setting m equals 0, though we couldn't do that, we couldn't do that directly in the Lagrangian for describing the massless particle. We certainly could do this in the Hamilton-Jacobi description of massless particles. So the Hamilton-Jacobi description unifies massive and massless motion. Just set m squared equals 0 in the Hamilton-Jacobi description, and you get the motion of massless particles. Okay, now in the exercises, we will try to take you through. Now you remember that the should we do in the? Yeah, I think we'll do in the exercises because we're somehow not going fast enough in this course, right? So we'll do it in the exercises. We'll take you through. You remember that just at the level of the equation of motion, the geodesic equation for a massive particle was the following. It was dx alpha by d tau of d alpha dx beta by d tau. Okay. What we said about the Hamilton-Jacobi equation implies the following, and I will try to get you to convince yourself of that in the exercises. There's almost no convincing to do, but okay, you think about it. You take k alpha, which is del psi by del x alpha. This was the thing that was the momentum in the Hamilton-Jacobi description and was like the wave number vector and massless motion. Okay? Maybe I can just, at the level of an analogy, it's all, what I'm saying is almost obvious, though we'll make you do some work with this. Suppose I rewrote this equation for a massive particle in terms of its momentum. Or let's do it this way, that makes it really clear. Let's write this as d by d dx alpha. When I say derivative with respect to x alpha with the lower, what I mean is derivative with respect to alpha, x alpha with an upper, lowered by the metric. Raised by the metric. Okay, S was equal to dx alpha by d tau up to a factor of n. It was proportional. Okay, so this equation told you that ds by dx alpha d alpha ds by d it doesn't matter, up or lower, is equal to 0. Okay? Since this must be derivable from the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, Since both are true equations, both follow from classical mechanics. We've not done them here, but you'll do that in the exercise. You'll check that these two. You can just go from the wave equation to this thing. Frankly, I've never done this exercise myself, but you guys will do it and show me how it's done. Okay. Or I'll work it out. Okay. The same thing must be true, you know, because the mathematics is the same when you replace by psi. So d psi by dx alpha, d psi by dx beta must be equal to 0. If we define d psi by dx beta to be equal to k beta, as we have before in studying iconal motion, this becomes the geodesic equation. This becomes the geodesic equation for the motion of a massless particle, k alpha d alpha of k beta. Okay? And thinking of the motion of a massless particle, remember k squared is equal to 0. From the wave equation, massless particle. Thinking of a motion of a massless particle by being k beta is equal to dx beta by d some number. This definition. This gives you the trajectory of this massless particle. Okay. So what I'm saying is that in studying the motion of massless particles, most often the most convenient way is to use this Hamilton-Jacobi equation directly. Sometimes you might find it convenient to use the geodesic equation. Also, the fact that the Hamilton-Jacobi equation for mass of particles is equivalent to the geodesic equation means that the same is true for massless particles, where the geodesic equation is a geodesic equation for the wave number, for this wave vector k alpha. Okay, these last few remarks may have seemed a bit obscure. We'll flesh them out in your assignment, so you note that down to measure. Okay, excellent. Now, we're going to be shoot out of this room pretty soon, very unfortunately. So let's move as fast as we can. Excellent. Questions or comments about this before we proceed? Okay. So what we've done is to understand particle motion and massless particle motion in a nice way, in general relativity, in curved background. Okay. There are two other things that I want to discuss before we start discussing the formulation of Einstein's field equations. And these two other things are the following. The first of these is to try to give you more intuition. For being in curved space. Okay? I remember when I was a student, roughly at your stage of your education, I remember being finding general relativity very hard to understand. Because, you know, all the familiar notions, distance and time, and all seem to have evaporated. I remember asking my professor, look, I read, you know, in journals that the Andromeda galaxy is so many light years away from us. What precisely does that statement mean? Okay, if you make a statement in a journal, it has to have a precise meaning. What is the precise meaning in general relativity? This kind of stuff really confused me. And I remember that section 84 in Landau, reading section, you know, I was making the big mistake of reading this big fat book, this telephone directory, Nisner, Thorne and Wheeler, which I think is an awful book, so that shouldn't be said in front of the camera. Then I started reading Landau-Lifshitz, and suddenly all was clear. You see, so 4 o'clock, 7. 5 minutes more. Okay. When preparing for this lecture, when I read it again, I couldn't see exactly why again. I remember I found section 84 extremely illuminating. So I can't really see... I can't anymore see the point of it so much, but somehow when I was learning the subject, it was very important to me, so I'm going to tell you about it. Okay. This is a section on what do distances and times mean in general relativity. Okay. So the question that Landau asks is, okay, we've got these abstract coordinate systems, but we're sort of physicists and we want to think about, you know, things. And these abstract coordinate systems are irritating, of course. So let me imagine the following. Let me imagine that every fixed x is the trajectory of an observer. Okay? That we've got a three-parameter set of observers filling space-time. These observers sit at xi, the three spatial xi's equals constant, and propagate along in time. So given a coordinate system, I will associate to it a three-parameter set of observers. Given another coordinate system, I will associate that. Another three-parameter set of observers. This kind of thing that, by the way, Einstein did a lot while trying to understand special relativity. I don't know if you've read about all these clocks and meter sticks and all that he was quite obsessed by. Yeah. So if you come from a special relativity background, it's natural to want to try to think of things this way. Okay. So, though I emphasize it's not the way any practitioner today actually thinks of such, but still, maybe it's useful to get into the subject. Okay? So I've got let's say I've got one three-parameter set of observers. Now, I want to know how far is my neighboring observer from me? I'll ask later if I can ask this question over finite distances, but at least infinitesimally. How far is the observer, my neighboring observer, from me? Now, you know, one of the lessons of general relativity, as in all of 20th century physics, is that if you ask a question, you should be able to imagine an experiment that can answer it. Otherwise, the question may not have an answer. Okay? So when you ask, how far is that guy from me? It sounds like a good question, but you have to give meaning to that question. Okay? Now, over infinitesimal distances, let's say I'm here at x equals 0. And I've got another observer friend who's at delta x. I'm going to give meaning to this question as follows.
These two observers are in different frames.
No, same frame. In a given frame, you want to break up. You want to understand, you know, you've got one observer labeled by x, another observer labeled by x plus delta x. These x and delta x are just xi's, okay, spatial x. You want to know how far the guy at x plus delta x is away from you. The answer must somehow be contained in the metric. But you want a spatial distance, not an interval. There's an interval between two events, that's clear. But that's not the thing that you want to know. You want to know, this guy is standing, he's moving. But how far is he away from you? You know, it sounds like an intuitively reasonable question. You have to make it precise in order to get an answer. One way of making it precise is this. You are a world observer doing this. Your friend is doing that. Ask your friend to hold up a mirror. Shine a ray of light. It goes to your friend, it bounces back. Measure how long it takes to come back. Divide that time by 2, assign that distance to your friend. Because light travels at speed 1. Through this course, speed of light is 1. Okay. Restored by dimensional analysis. Okay? Sounds like a reasonable definition of distance, right? Okay? At least infinitesimally, sounds like a reasonable definition of distance. Do you agree with this? We're going to work out what this definition gives us. Okay? It sounds like a reasonable definition of space. What? Please.
Are we assuming space to be flat? Because
no.
Then how are we dividing by 2?
Because light travels.
Yeah, but if space is curved, then the curvatures might be different in the two trajectories.
This is an infinitesimal range.
So you are assuming that.
Yeah. So infinitesimally, space is locally flat.
Okay.
Right. Yes. Yeah, I suppose that was your question. Yes. So the answer is yes. In this region, you know, curvature is like an infinitesimal square effect, as we will see as we go along. Okay. Fine. So how do we make this question precise? Well, it's very easy. Remember that two points connected by a ray of light travels along null rays, as we've seen. Okay? So two points connected by a ray of light are separated by zero space-time interval. So suppose we send out our light ray from x equals 0 at t equals 0. We want to know when it will have reached our friend. Okay? We want to know the answer to when will it have reached our friend. What is the answer to that question? Well, we get that answer by solving a quadratic equation. Say that it reaches our friend at time delta t. The equation we have to solve is g00 delta t squared plus 2 delta t g0i delta xi plus gij delta xi delta xj 0. Solving this quadratic equation will tell us how long it took. Okay, so let's solve. So we get delta t is equal to minus b, so minus 2 g0i delta xi plus minus b squared, so we keep a factor of 2 out, g0i delta xi the whole thing squared minus 4ac. The 4 is this 2. 2 cancels the denominator. A here was g00. So, minus g00 gij delta xi delta xj. Oh, we've gone out of the line. But okay, fine. Okay? Now, you see, there are two light rays here that starting from here, okay, would do the job. One that came from the past, and then one that went to the future. Okay? So now if we just change our point of view, we do this calculation for this guy, then the two light rays are the ones that we actually want. Do you see? Okay? And the time difference between them is just the difference between these two roots. Do you see? Okay? So, the time difference. So, this time difference. Okay? T diff, oh my, we really have to stop soon, is equal to 2 square root g0i delta xi, the whole thing squared, minus g00 gij delta xi delta xj, divided by g00. Now, this is the coordinate time difference. But our observers are sophisticated. They know that they should be measuring proper time. Then they can divide this by 2 and get the right distance. But the proper time is related to this coordinate time by factor square root g00. Clearly? So I'll put a square root. So square root g00 is delta tau is equal to this. This is the answer for the distance. So the distance square, which gives me a spatial metric. Distance square, and then I should divide by 2. So this goes away. So the distance squared is given by gij, the effective spatial metric is gamma ij, so it's gij minus minus g0i g0j divided by g00. So squaring this. Okay, we're through. Okay, I think we're going to have to postpone things to the next class. Just, this is the punchline. This is the effective distance assigned to neighboring observers by the definition that we just prescribed. We'll come back to that to this next class. Okay, please let's go out. And I had one question to ask you people about scheduling.